April 1968, 124 American cities used National Guard troops to put down riots after Dr. Martin Luther King's assassination. One of them was Wilmington, Delaware. Guardsmen patrolled in some cities through the spring and even into the summer. But in Wilmington, the Guard remained on the streets for 9.5 months. It is still the longest military occupation of an American city since the Civil War.
Promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory of
this evening, Martin Luther King was shot in Tennessee.
As soon as the news of Dr. King's death and shooting, I think most police officers, black and white, had a feeling that something was going to happen in Wilmington.
In some ways, I'm very surprised that we were also surprised when a riot broke out here in Wilmington. Why were we surprised?
There's no doubt in my mind there was going to be an explosion. All it needed was the fuse and light the fuse, and that was the assassination of Dr. King.
Since the 1965 uprising in the Los Angeles ghetto Watts, American cities had become racial war zones. In city after city, authorities used their police, the FBI, the National Guard, and even the armed forces to quell the violence. But after the smoke cleared, Black America's anger was still there. The racial violence of the mid-60s erupted after years of nonviolent protests for freedom. Jim Crow laws separating blacks and whites had governed life in the South for nearly 100 years. In Delaware, as in other former slave states, Jim Crow was a fact of life. In the 1950s, few signs announced whites only, but Delaware's blacks and whites still observed the unspoken rules of segregation.
It was a time of staying in your place, not rocking the boat.
You did not drink from the same water fountain. You did not use the same bathroom. In the court in which I am a judge now, you sat in a specific area if you were black.
Lewis Redding, then Delaware's only black lawyer, began challenging Jim Crow in court as early as 1950. In that year, a group of black students sued the University of Delaware, demanding admission to the all-white freshman class. They won. Leonard Williams was among the first black students to graduate.
I felt that that was an obligation and a challenge for me to deal with, and I'd probably be better prepared to deal with it if I'd gone to the University of Delaware as a small minority than had I gone to an all-black school.
Meanwhile, much of Wilmington remained off-limits to blacks. In 1958, a restaurant that rented space from the city refused to serve a city councilman because he was black. Dutch Burton sued and won his case in court, but the fight for access to restaurants and other public places persisted even into the 60s.
I decided to quit the pot and go to law school so I could become my own lawyer. And I did that just basically because I wanted to work in civil rights.
There was a custom to keep down and to keep out black folk.
I read about the NAACP picketing the Rialto Theater, which was one of the theaters that I went to. And I was kind of stunned to suddenly realize that black kids weren't allowed to go see the same movies I was seeing in the theaters that I was allowed to go into.
Even today, when you sing We Shall Overcome, I cry. Because it was such a potent song. And it really captured the whole feeling.
To this day, I feel sorry for people who were not involved at that time because they missed something.
By the mid-60s, the younger generation of blacks had grown impatient. You could get into a movie, you could eat in any restaurant. It wasn't enough.
This kind of crap is not going to be tolerated by the black community any longer.
July 1967, shots are fired into a bar in Wilmington's Little Italy. Witnesses claim the shots came from a car full of black men that cruised through the neighborhood that night. For the next two nights, gangs of men from two neighborhoods, Little Italy and the Valley, a mostly black neighborhood, prepare for street battle.
There's several truckloads of people from Little Italy were heading toward the Valley, and we were able to mobilize enough police officers to meet them at Broome Street and convince them that that was not the thing to do.
There were guns everywhere. I mean, you could glance up at the second floor windows and people were sitting in the second floor windows with rifles, shotguns, whatever.
If they'd have got into the Valley that night, there would have been some people hurt or maybe killed.
We gather here this morning in one of the darkest hours in the history of the black people of this nation.
King represented hope to a generation of black Americans. Now they mourned him, while their children seethed with anger and frustration.
The commemorative services went off without an incident. It was after the services that a couple of gangs decided to needle each other and they started the ruckus.
The word came down and people just started coming out in the streets and just started from there, just like bam, it just happened.
There was pushing and shoving. And the next thing you know, windows were being broken out. 35, 40, 50 youth at a time would go into a store and loot it, where you know, the operator or owner or salespeople couldn't stop them. And then it just started building, and then it just escalated, and then it blew.
That night, the fires begin. 14 people are injured, 5 of gunshot wounds. 54 people are arrested. There are 8 cases of sniping and 19 cases of looting. The heart of the trouble is in the Valley, the 24-block area west of Center City. At 9:45 p.m., Mayor Babiarz declares a state of emergency.
When King got killed, we all said that if America kills a nonviolent man, then there is no other result but to turn to violence. So we figured we fight fire with fire.
I was coming back in town here, and you could see smoke rising from this West Center City area.
We knew something was cooking because the phone lines just went crazy. I mean, the boards, I'd never seen anything like this at all.
This April 8th, 1968, I had my arm busted. Driving engine 2's wagon to a fire at 12th and Pine. I was bombarded by a mess of bricks from the rooftops and the streets. It was a real hectic night.
I couldn't hardly breathe because of smoke. And I remember laying in the gutter where the water was coming down from the fire engines, just trying to get water on my face.
We were afraid, well, at least I was afraid, that it might catch, you know, to my house.
If they want to set their house on fire, at that time I felt that it burned.
Who ever thought that it would come to the riotous conditions that it did? I mean, the city was burning and we were being fired upon. And we were firing back. Make no mistake about it. I did. I fired. And it was terrible.
His police and firefighting force exhausted, Mayor Babiarz asks Governor Charles Terry for help.
They had things pretty well under control. It wasn't escalating, but they were tired and they needed some help just to take their places overnight. And as I said, the governor reacted. He mobilized the entire guard.
We needed additional help for the local police department in this city. And thank God they did come.
Here's your hometown, and when you ride in and see and feel, and you have an M1 in between your legs, and you see the black smoke bellowing from Madison Street over top of the rooftops, you don't know. It's real scary.
We were told that the building was in danger of being, that people were trying to get into it, and there was a riot going on outside, and that we had to get under our desks.
And that day, I was ready to leave. I told my husband, I said, come on, let's go to my mother's. Let's pack up and leave.
I had a piece of black pipe, it's about the size of a gun barrel. And I just opened the door a crack and stuck the end of the pipe out.
It might have been our neighborhood, but it wasn't our stores. We didn't own it. We didn't have no say-so of what was going on. And we was just striking back.
My wife drove me in here. The freeway wasn't in yet. And she drove up Penny Hill, and she said she looked back and the city was on fire. She could see flames and smoke. She called in here to see how I was. And I didn't get home until the next day. I came home, she was lying in bed. It was like in the morning, she hadn't awakened yet, with a shotgun under the bed.
Wednesday, April 10th, the rioting is over. Wilmington picks up the pieces after 2 days of looting, sniping, and burning.
I was talking to the governor that things had quieted down and that he should remove the rest of the guard, and he refused to do that.
If General Scannell's recommendation had been followed at the end of that week and the guard had been sent home, they would have been heroes in the neighborhoods that had suffered most of the damage during the disturbances, especially West Center City.
Remains in Wilmington, though forces have been removed in every other city.
People won't say it now, won't admit it, but a lot of white folks felt very comfortable seeing the guard out every day.
There was a fear in the suburbs that it was going to somehow or other spread, that it was catchable, that those mobs of angry blacks were somehow or other going to storm the suburbs.
It was unbelievable if you didn't live through it, to be honest with you. It was literally like like a foreign country occupying. Like, you know, like white Delaware occupying black Delaware.
We really didn't have the training coming in.
Lots of times they were around and you, they want to know where you were going, where'd you live.
You couldn't even step out the front door without them zooming up, saying get back in the house with their guns, you know, drawn on.
They did a thoroughly professional job doing work for which they hadn't been trained and which they shouldn't have been used for.
Everybody's frightened and everybody's separated from their family, even though we all know that's part of the territory and joining the guard. Everybody's separated, nobody's work, everybody's separated from their work, and they're sort of out of context, and now we're practicing riot control. It was strange. It was real strange.
Times were changing. The order of things was changing. There was a sense that the old rules weren't working. Everything had been comfortable, everything had been cozy. All of a sudden in 68, it seemed like there was a new edge to life.
Something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Haven't you ever been to Lovett?
As long as we stay out here and do things right, we'll have no problem.
There's battle lines being drawn. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speak in their minds. I'm getting so much resistance from behind. Time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
The media were as much a part of 1968 as the events they covered. The local newspaper reported that Governor Terry mobilized the entire state's National Guard. This gave the impression that there were thousands of armed soldiers on the streets. That was not true. Although the Guard was authorized to enlist 3,500 men, in reality, it only had about 3,000. Of those, only 800 actually went into Wilmington. The governor removed most of those troops within a week, leaving a force of just 60 on most days. Television's appetite for action was just awakening in 1968, and violent events of that year were tailor-made for it. The news showed America as it had never seen itself before.
If there was no action, they'd see some kids, they'd say, come on, just start jumping around, making some noise, and the cameras would grind.
Wilmington became a place you visited only if you had to, and then only during daylight hours. Many suburbanites' only view of Wilmington came through their TV sets and their local paper.
People stopped coming in town. That was not it, you know, Wilmington's business district was in decline, but it went to zero after that.
Around the country, tempers cool with the temperature. The long, hot summer is over.
All the leaves are brown.
Frustrated, Mayor Babiarz issues a public plea to the governor to take the Guard off the streets. Governor Terry again says no.
After the murder of Martin Luther King, the National Guard was called out in several cities to put down riots. One of these cities was Wilmington, Delaware. But now, in Wilmington, the National Guard is still on duty, and the governor, Charles Terry, has no plan to send it back.
We're the only city in the nation that's got the National Guard still riding around. I mean, everybody else has started the rebuilding process, and we're still riding, you know, with the Guard.
I remember it's like we was in a, I guess like a prison camp.
It was pretty shocking that Governor Terry kept the Guard in for so long. I mean, on the surface, there just didn't seem to be any reason for the Guard to be here that long.
Now that patrol is in there to protect every citizen and every citizen's property in that city. It's not a police patrol. It's a patrol to keep crowds from assembling that would result in rioting.
Charles Lehman Terry was born in rural Kent County in 1900. William McKinley was president. It would be 3 years before the first cross-country automobile trip and 15 years before the first telephone call.
Charles Terry was brought up in Kent County in the early part of this century, and he reflected the views of a segregated society.
In 1927, Terry married and, following in his father's footsteps, set up his law practice in Dover. He began his career of public service in 1938 as a Superior Court judge and rose to become the state Supreme Court Chief Justice in 1963. A year later, he was elected governor.
He's a man of great warmth and charm and magnetism and, you know, entirely a man's man. He loved to hunt, and there was just an aura about him that, and I think anybody who knew him will testify to that.
He was almost a 19th century gentleman. He was asked to lead the state, or expected to lead the state, during a period of upheaval that was just foreign to all of his experience.
Perhaps Terry's closest advisor as governor was his press secretary, Ned Davis.
There were a group of black women that he had invited in during the time of the welfare strife. The governor and said, well, I think the paramount need is jobs. We need to find jobs for those boys. And he looked up and he said, I can see you bristle when I say that. He said, but you really shouldn't. He said, you know, I'm an old man. To me, Ned over here is a boy, and I was almost 40, I guess, or at least in my mid-30s. He said, he's a boy to me. He said, I don't mean anything by it.
Little Mitchell made some remarks about how black people feel about Charles Terry. And the governor at this press conference said, my man Charles says Little Mitchell does not speak for the black people, implying that my man Charles, his houseboy, did speak for the black people.
Wesley. That's not what Wesley would say. No.
Good evening, Miss Valley.
Good evening, Wesley.
Charles Wesley Atkins went to work in the Terrys' home in 1927 and worked for them for 42 years.
He would look at me and say, Wesley, that's interesting. I didn't think that. That's nice to think about that. That's interesting. And I'd be very frank with him. I would say certain things to him, and we'd just talk like one of the family. I do believe if the guards didn't stay, it would have been worse than it really was.
We have here in the office at least 3,000 or 3,500 letters, telegrams, begging us to keep them on the street.
No matter black or white, a person, if he is in favor of law and order, should not be irritated by the presence of the guard. It shouldn't bother them.
Well, I feel the guards are harassing our neighborhood. They're taking our pride. They ride up and down the streets at night like we're animals or something of this sort, and we're not animals.
I don't think nothing really bad happened in Wilmington, that the guards have to stay here constantly.
I think it's absolutely necessary that the National Guard remain on patrol here in the city of Wilmington, and the intelligence information that the governor, Governor Terry, has agrees with what I have been able to dig up, that is the only thing that's kept the lid on the city of Wilmington throughout the summer.
He saw this unrest as the beginning of a revolution. He was being fed terrible information by people who were not credible, and he chose to believe it.
At Ferris Industrial School, there were a group of youngsters who were feeding, mouthing off a lot of things, and the superintendent of the school at that time was a friend of the governor, a hunting buddy, and he transmitted this information to the governor. Then they were convinced that things weren't finished yet, there would be still problems.
Governor Terry had shown no reluctance to use the guard. In March 1968, he sent state troopers to break up a welfare demonstration and kept the guard on standby for 5 days. 2 months later, he used the guard to remove students who had seized the administration building at Delaware State College. But none of these events provoked resentment the way the prolonged guard patrols did.
Since I've been in Delaware, and I've been in here 40 years, he's the worst governor that we had so far, to my knowledge.
I guess you'd say he's the governor who did that. But there are a lot of people and a lot of forces in this community that helped keep them there.
Poor Governor Terry. The ones who complained, I think, were not responsible black people or white people. I think those that complained were the ones that were enjoying their rioting.
Law and order is the only real issue in this campaign, in my opinion, nationally and locally.
Less than a week after his interview aired in October, at the height of his re-election campaign, Governor Terry suffered a heart attack. His opponent was retired DuPont Company chemist Russell Peterson, whose liberal Republican views included support for the guard's withdrawal.
In every other place, they kept that guard on the streets for like 8 hours, 24 hours, maybe even 48 hours. But to keep them on the streets for 9.5 months, every night driving through the black neighborhoods, was strictly outrageous.
I think that 80% of the people that we came into contact with between the period of April and September 1 were in favor of it. And I think that after that there was some shift, and I think that people did feel that the presence was a little embarrassing.
The governor was convinced that he was going to ride the victory based on his iron fist. It turned out that we both lost. I couldn't criticize him. We were both running for office on the same ticket, so I had to bite my tongue and keep quiet.
So I'm telling you right now, only the strong survive. Only the strong survive. Hey, you gotta be strong.
I knew what the feeling in the black community was, that the guard was just making them mad and creating a problem. We all sat down and see how if a Republican could win. We went through the black vote and the Chinese vote and everything, and it, no way could we win. Don't ask me. I just suddenly changed my mind for no good reason. 1 week later, I'm leading 2-1.
Haskell's gamble paid off. The guard's presence overwhelmed Babiarz's administration and elected Haskell, the first Republican elected mayor in 16 years. Republican Peterson upset Terry, but whether the guard issue or his failing health defeated Terry is still uncertain.
There is no question about it, in my mind, that I won the election in spite of that guard issue. The statistics we had, my own personal contacts with people indicated that my position on that guard issue was hurting me seriously.
We had a governor at that time, Charles Terry, who, but for civil rights, would probably have been one of the greatest governors that Delaware ever had. He never could understand what they wanted.
Minutes after being sworn into office, Governor Peterson orders the guard off the streets of Wilmington. It is exactly 9 months and 12 days since Governor Terry sent them in.
The patrols have helped breed fear and suspicion and hate, and have tended to divide the black and white communities at a time when the overriding need is for unity and mutual trust.
I mean, the bottom line was, you know, control the Negroes.
Some blacks argue that Holloway, without it, we wouldn't have gotten the white folks' attention. I don't think it was worth it. I don't think it was worth it.
Hey, if that's what it took to, you know, to get response, you know, to what we wanted, then that's what we had to do. And if burning was the way to do it, then that's the way it had to be done.
I wish I'd been able to be part of the solution rather than just another one of the many white people wandering around wondering what was going on in the black community.
Those of us that were involved in it often talk about it and we'll never forget it.
We actually went through a mini revolution in the decade of the 60s. And when I mention that to people today, you know, they shake their heads. We did. I said, we sure did.
I look back in those times, on those times, each time I look in the mirror and see these gray hair.
You're either on the side of change or you're on the side of the status quo. I came down on the side for change. A lot of my friends came down on the other side. And we haven't all changed that much.
Maybe someday we'll have 1968 again.
Shine!